wonderful session. Any questions from the audience? Thank you, ma'am. Moving to the next talk, I would like to call upon stage Dr. Abhilasha Narayanan. Madam is consultant gynec oncologist at Apollo Hospital, Bangalore. Her main areas of interest is gynec oncology. She'll be enlightening us about abnormal pap smear during pregnancy and recommendations for management.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. Thank you, organizers, for giving me this opportunity. Today being the last session, I would like to keep this talk very short, crisp, with a good take-home message. How to move this? Use the right arrow. Not working. Not working. This one? I did it.
Turn it like this.
No, it's not working. Thank you. So, we all as women like to celebrate womanhood, cherish it, but when it comes to oncology, that's not the case. The two exclusive organs we have, that is breast and cervix, are the most common sites of cancer. So, as you can see, this is the Globocon 2018 data, where I'm comparing 2008 and 2012. There is just a role reversal between breast and cervical cancer. The breast was the leading is the leading cancer now. The second most is the cervix. Before it was cervix followed by breast. Don't know whether the cervix is coming down or breast is on the race. We are hopeful that cervix is coming down because of all the screening and vaccinations, etc. Today I'm speaking on the most common test performed by the gynecologist, but in a special circumstance. So there's no consensus as to what to do, what not to do in this. But with few recommendations, we would like to arrive at some consensus at the end of this talk. What is the need for pap smear? The need is because it's the second most common cancer in women in India, and most of the most of our Indians never go for screening, and most of the screenings in India is an opportunistic screening. So pregnancy should be taken as an opportunity, and we should go ahead with screening. But various recommendations, they differ. Like coming to RCOG, there they have a coordinated screening programs. So they say because the women is always been screened and the previous pap screenings are normal, you can just postpone your pap smear to postpartum 6 to 12 weeks. You need not screen during pregnancy even if you're due. But there are exceptions. Exceptions is if she's not done it for quite a long time and she's never started or it's clinically looking abnormal, you can go ahead and do your pap screenings. What does our FOXI say? FOXI says there is no consensus. Just do a per-speculum examination. If you think it looks abnormal, go ahead with a pap smear. If you think it's normal, you just postpone it for the postpartum period. But a little bit I would like to differ. It's because of the same thing. If the woman is compliant, has been regularly screening, maybe you can skip the pap smear because it causes too much anxiety, apprehension, a lot of interpretational difficulties. But if you are in a rural setup and the woman is unlikely to show up, pregnancy is a huge opportunity because she will definitely come for at least one antenatal checkup. She will come to the hospital. So we should use it as an opportunity to screen and detect any pre-invasive lesions which might in the future go ahead and cause invasive cancer. And at present, we have almost 1.5 to 1.6 lakh new incidents per year every year. And almost 70% are dying because of it. So I think for India, all those recommendations won't help. I would suggest opportunistic screening, both at patients' and clinicians' discretion. And there is no different screening guidelines if it is pregnancy. If they are due, you just do it. If they are overdue also, you just do it. Same guidelines, start by around 21 to 25 years, every 3 yearly. With if you're doing cytology alone, or if you're combining it with a HPV DNA testing, do it once in 5 years and continue till 65 years of age. Pap smear safety has been proven. maybe some spotting occurs, but pregnancy per se is not affected. Maybe the anxiety level of the patient slightly increases. And the only recommendation for this is never use a wooden spatula or a plastic spatula which you use. Use a broom type brush here. That's the only, and never use a cyto brush or an endocervical brush to take a smear. The broom type brush which we use for the LBC method or the HPV method, that is the best method and least harmful, found to be least harmful. The problem comes is in pregnancy is, next is interpretation of pap results. Because of hormonal changes of pregnancy, there are various changes like hyperplasia, atypia, there is area stellar reaction wherein the nuclear cytoplasmic ratio is raised, lot of immature cells, so you pick up even syncytiotrophoblasts, cytotrophoblasts, so lot of interpretational problem is there. That's why keep your cytopathologist in loop, so they are of a big help. Keep them in the loop, keep them update them on your clinical findings also so that they would be able to interpret it better. Not only in pap smear, you will have interpretational problem and also procedural problems in colposcopy. Because if you do it in first trimester, the TZ might be very inside, you might not do a satisfactory colposcopy, then you postpone to do it in second trimester, then the chances are that there is supine hypotension if you do it for long, so probably you need to little bit raise the hip up, one hip up. Anxiety levels, uncomfort level is more, bleeding is more, the cervix is more friable. So that is the procedural difficulty. There is also interpretational difficulty because of lot of vasodilatation, the cyanosis will be there. So that gives a dusky hue. So vessels look very prominent because of vasodilatation. So you might interpret as actually a more severe lesion. But after application of ustic acid because of edema, the dense astrovite areas appear lighter. So probably you will think it's, you will interpret it in another way. So it's why both actually. It's like a two-edged sword, but if you keep doing it, you will get an idea whether it's a low-grade lesion or a high-grade lesion. So in general, PAP is reported the same. It's reported the same. Either it's for benefit purpose, you can just, in pregnancy, you can interpret as low-grade lesions or high-grade lesions. Anything L-cell and ascus comes as low-grade lesions. Anything HCL, AGC, ASCH, or anything favoring neoplasia are high-grade lesions. So how do you manage any abnormal PAP result? Any abnormal PAP result, basically you need a colposcopy to evaluate. So low-grade lesions, we'll just show off the low-grade cytology. So you have a LCL or a ASCUS, you just tell them, we'll repeat your colposcopy postpartum. 6 to 12 weeks. So all your low-grade cytologies, you will just screen off. So any other lesions other than LCL and ASCUS, like AGC, ASCH, HCL, you need to go ahead and do your colposcopy. And then glandular abnormalities, actually, ideally speaking, you should do a ECC and a EB. Here, obviously, it's contraindicated. Other than that, the procedure goes about in the same fashion. Biopsy, there's a lot of controversies here also. The safety of colposcopy and biopsy is established in many studies other than slightly increased bleeding. It doesn't usually affect the pregnancy if you take a small biopsy basically. Here also in colposcopy wise, based on your scores, if you have a low scores, low grade lesions, don't do a biopsy. Just postpone it for postpartum 6 to 12 weeks. You have high grade lesions, like more suspicious of CIN 2, 3, and your read index or your SEED scores gives more than like 6, 8 and all that. Or clinically, there is an obvious lesion. Please don't differ from doing a biopsy. Always do a biopsy and document it because it helps in ruling out invasive disease. Our purpose is only to rule out invasive cancer throughout the pregnancy and push off any other lesions like CIN 2, 3 to postpartum period. Only purpose is to rule out, we are not missing out on invasive disease, whether clinically, cytologically or colposcopically. But certain countries differ in this. The national program in Australia recently released a 2019 recommendation saying that biopsy is usually unnecessary. They just say go ahead with your scoring. If you think it's a low grade lesion or a high grade lesion, you just map it on colposcopic impression. Don't prove it with biopsy. But I don't think so in Indian scenario it works so well. And if you have a high-grade lesion, what they do is, you have a high-grade lesion, we biopsy it and rule out cervical cancer. What they do is, they repeat colposcopy after 12 to 14 weeks probably to see whether they are progressing. Like your score is about 5, did it become 8, something like that. And certain situations we are not able to diagnose, but there is a strong clinical suspicion. I'm looking, it looks like a mass, but biopsy comes out negative. Or cytology is showing a SCC, squamous carcinoma cells, but biopsy didn't come out. Then sometimes we might have to go ahead and do a little bit of colonization because we might not access the endocervical area. Just last two slides. We might not access the endocervical area, but here we can't do a therapeutic colonization. We might have to do a little bit undershot, not reach till internal loss and do, but obviously after explaining and taking consent of the patient, because we are not supposed to lose the patient because of missed malignancy. But colonization has a lot of bad pregnancy outcomes with preterm labor, bleeding, etc. And almost 5 to 10% go in for preterm labor due to PROM or chorioamnionitis. When do you reevaluate a high-grade lesion? As I told you, repeat it 12 weeks later. Rest all low-grade lesions, everything else, you do it postpartum. That is, see, the cytology was LC lascus during your pregnancy. You do a colposcopy at 6, 12 weeks postpartum. And you have a cytology of high-grade lesions. In whatever colposcopic findings, if the colposcopy was negative also, you repeat your PAP and colposcopy postpartum. But if you had a low-grade cytology, like for LCL, you did a colposcopy and found a low-grade lesion, you need not do a colposcopy and biopsy. You can just repeat a PAP smear 6 to 12 weeks postpartum. So to sum it all, these are all based on certain guidelines. Nobody has consensus basically, but most of the country's experts opine that PAP screening should be continued as usual. This is for LCL lesions. You can defer colposcopy postpartum, or preferably if you think the patient won't turn up or it's a very high risk patient with HPV positive, you can go ahead doing a colposcopy and a biopsy. For HCL lesions, if it is a satisfactory colposcopy or an unsatisfactory colposcopy. If it's a satisfactory colposcopy, no need to repeat it. Just mark your high-grade lesions by colposcopic impression or by biopsy, and then follow it up postpartum, unless there is a progression. And if you have a type 3 TZ, that's you have an unsatisfactory colposcopy, please repeat it in second or third trimester, so that you have not missed out of any lesions there. And any CA comes, CIN2-3, everything, most CIN2-3 is dealt postpartum. And anything CA comes, it is dealt accordingly based on the stage and gestational age. Thank you.
Dr. Abhilasha, I just have one question. You have actually cleared quite a few myths that, you know, we can do a pap smear during pregnancy, and it's a golden opportunity because it's got a high negative predictive value. You know that woman is not sick. She's had chronic cervicitis. Now, do you recommend HPV screening as mandatorily for all patients?
I definitely do. See, pap smear interpretation by cytopathologist varies. It varies. So many times, too much of inflammatory background, you don't treat it. And most of the time, some ascus turns up. So it's interpretationally, if this ascus is not caused by HPV, I'm not worried. So always do a co-testing if the woman is more than 30 years.
So it's better to do
a Always do a co-test. Now US Preventive Task Force is saying that only one of the organization in US is saying do only primary HPV, the two high-risk HPV testing. But I don't advocate it. Always correlate it with a cytological abnormality. A cytological abnormality caused by a HPV, I am worried. A cytological abnormality not caused by HPV, I am least bothered because it takes 10, 15 years for CA to develop.
If you have a typical, this is a typical postpartum lady who's had a normal pap smear but incidentally found to be HPV positive for 6 and 18.
Nothing happens. See, women till 30 years, we will be keeping having HPV infections. We will ward it off if
but
you
how,
leave it.
What is the surveillance protocol?
Yeah, see, ideally speaking, we don't know when we are infected, but we can give our body 2 years' time. That's what we say. We give 2 years' time for us to clear off the infection, basically. So we can't wait till 2 years. So anyone who is HPV positive with a low-grade cytology, repeat HPV testing yearly till she becomes negative. Once she is negative, go back to her 5-yearly protocol. But HPV positive with a high grade cytology, anything, HCL, ASCH and all that, go ahead and do a colposcopy, do a biopsy, rule out high grade lesions, and then again check HPV next year just to make sure that HPV has gone.
HPV is positive, pap smear is negative. You said you will do HPV yearly.
After 1 year.
Do you also check paps again because it's negative now?
See, pap was negative. Unless clinically indicated, you need not do. But nowadays, pathologists, they're very good. When single smear, they're doing everything. So if they're doing it, you can do it. It's only based on cost perspective. If clinically cervix looks normal and there is no AGC,
so
and only
HPV.
Squamous cells, only you can just repeat your HPV.
Thank you so much for that rapid fire.
Thank you.
Thanks.